This project is the first toe in the water for a group of us here at Duke that are interested in helping communities that are underserved and don't have sufficient capacity and resources to do climate adaptation and resilience planning on their own. And the idea is, how can we help them? What does that look like? Do they need data collected? Do they need help with developing planning models? And this City of Creswell case that we did with the Data Plus students is helping us evaluate what that looks like and hopefully build out a process that could be replicated in other communities that have similar needs.
There was a federal act passed in 2022 designating a bunch of communities as especially high risk for climate-related disasters or just occurrences. So the community we're working with is in rural North Carolina. It suffers pretty heavily from floods, so we're interested in mapping their stormwater system and then being able to simulate possible floods and recommend some solutions to limit those occurrences.
We are looking in this little town called Creswell, North Carolina, which is 3 hours away from Duke's campus, and they're very small, have a small population, but they're very susceptible to flood risks. So we're trying to understand what's causing those flood risks, and we're mapping a few things for them in terms of like their drainage system, the pipes, and a few of the ditches they have over there, and seeing what's wrong with those, and then hopefully using this data to help them in the future to be more prepared for these flooding risks.
Okay, if we were this town, what tools are available to us? What data is available to us? How do we start? And eventually, how do we use this data in a way that can help us make better decisions about climate adaptation? But not only that, something that this bigger initiative also wants to look at is the fact that some insurance companies, for them it's starting to get harder and harder to grant insurance to these communities, wherever it is available.
We started with the idea of using a resilience model called INCOR, developed I think out of the University of Illinois, which basically just looks at different types of hazards, whether that be floods or hurricanes or earthquakes, and then can use different data sets that like big cities typically have. Like most big cities have maps of their stormwater system. Most of them have a lot of information about the buildings and the codes that those buildings follow, but what we're finding is in the smaller community that we're working in, they don't have those like initial base data sets. So we're ultimately constructing a GIS file, which is kind of a map of the stormwater system. And then the idea is that becomes an input into some of these different models. The EPA has its EPA SWIM model, stormwater management model, and it takes all of these different like inputs about the stormwater system and then can simulate different flooding events. So we're trying to kind of reverse engineer some of those inputs right now. But then we ultimately actually went out to the city that we're working in, Creswell, and we're able to talk to the Public Works Department and the mayor and a couple of other people out there. And then we walked the stormwater system and kind of went out with pencil, paper, and a map and just started marking things down.
The town is about 4 by 2 blocks. It's a very small town. It's pretty flat, really, really flat. It's on the coast. They have this system of ditches rather than having sewer pipes like we would have in a city. And they just kind of drain towards the closest river, which is the Scuppernong River. Groundwater levels might be rising, and so a mix of that plus the ditches being too full of debris or sediments. The ditches were full when we went there. No rain, and the ditches were full of water.
Maybe data science is something that I didn't expect to be so like humanized, and going out to the community and being able to talk to these people I think was really eye-opening, because I mean I sat there and I looked at the map of the city for 3.5 weeks and it was kind of odd. We were like driving through the city, but I'd spent so much time like in the Google map that it was like deja vu, because I felt like I'd like been there before. I don't know, it's hard because it's like these people are facing real challenges and we sit here and we're trying, but it's definitely like being confronted with that was really powerful.
A mix of all the data they could find, plus some modeling, hydraulic modeling that we did, and then some basic damage calculations and looking at different scenarios. So for example, we're looking at, let's say, current sea level, right? And maybe we increase it by 1 foot and then another foot and see what the damages look like. And also beyond that, we might look at, okay, for each of these three scenarios, what happens if there is no rain or some rain or even slightly more rain, right? And so how do damages look? Because I think a lot of the data available might be sort of these static maps of coastal sea level elevation. But if we include rain, and it might look slightly different. And I think this is something we learned by visiting the community, because they mentioned that any rain now is starting to cause flooding events, not just the sea level rise by itself.
there's a lot of like disproportionate, I think, implications of climate science and the work that we're doing. And I think what we're doing is so important because we're really trying to give information back to these communities. But there's something that feels a little odd, or at least needs to be recognized, in that we're coming from an institution that has the money, the resources, and the power to kind of stave off climate change. And, you know, this community doesn't have that. So I think it's really important for us to be kind of conscious of like the privilege that we hold when we walk into those communities and to ask open-ended questions.
As the first climate leader in residence at the Nicholas Institute, I really want to send a shout out to the Nicholas family for the gift that they gave to the President's Climate Action and Innovation Fund that made this position possible. This project is so impressive because the students didn't view it as an academic or a technical exercise. They really understood it was a people exercise. So they went out there themselves, and it was really that kind of opportunity to work with a team that took it to the next level that I think makes the Nicholas Institute special, and really has made my time here really valuable for me and hopefully for the students I'm working with as well.
Yeah, we recently received great news that the city of Creswell is receiving funding from the state to do some additional climate resilience and climate adaptation planning. And hopefully the data that the students collected on stormwater would be able to help support the work that the consultants will do in that project. All the work that the students have done will be shared back with the partners on this project, which are the North Carolina Office of Recovery and Resilience and the City of Creswell.